something that's, I just love it. I thought it was fabulous. All the machinery on stage, what you're doing with shooting, and how does the, do you think that the technology that you're able to use, nobody's been, 20 years ago people wouldn't use, that changes the way people talk in art about war?
I'm not sure it's the technology so much as just the general approach to what an expert is supposed to be, and also that there are a number of people who do much more specialized things than in the past. That song, which is called Only an Expert, is just a series of short stories really about an expert's approach to talk, experts on talk shows, experts who look for weapons, experts who determine what's wrong with you. It was written out of the frustration of a... I have an example. It's actually a filmmaker, a friend of mine, a Scottish film director, who was in New York for a film festival, who came to one of the screenings. And do you know this person who's at the door with a clipboard who says, I don't see your name on the list here? And they said, I know I'm not on the list, but they said, I could see the film. And they said, well, who said you could see the film? And he said, well, she said, did you reach out to the press office? And he said, no, I called the press office. Reach out to the press office. It's like, why does your country have to be all about this language of therapy? Like, there's something wrong with you. So it started me thinking about this kind of overemphasization of this kind of attitude of improvement and the fact that it shouldn't be you who determines that, sort of ask your doctor, ask yourself, it's a part of this whole thing. So that was part of the inspiration for that song. But it ends in its last version, it's the last verse is about the experts who tell you whether it's a good idea or not to invade another country, a good idea or not to torture other people, a good idea or not to do that. And as long as there are enough experts who agree that it's a good idea, then it's just fine to invade. So, in other words, it's a, yes. Kind of
so does anybody want, this idea of, we know more, we have experts, we have specialists, we have technology which they're using and you're using.
What effect does that have on the way art is done, the way art is important?
Jeffrey, since you had to deal with it day to day.
Well, in thinking about it, it's really obvious that if the role of journalism is to get to the truth, then journalists aren't doing that. But artists are, so maybe artists should be journalists instead of journalists. Journalism struggles with this ridiculous idea that we have to be fairly balanced about everything, so that it gives equivalency, moral equivalency, to all sides, and some of them don't deserve that equivalency. They don't deserve that legitimacy. But the I think we are, as you mentioned, John, at the end of an era here, and we're seeing the kind of spasms of how 25 or 35 years of thinking about society and the role of journalism as defined by Richard Nixon, Margaret Thatcher, and Ronald Reagan is now starting to come to an end, and it's not necessarily a pretty sight, but it's definitely happening, and part of the reason that it's happening is that people are just fed up with it, and they're fed up with how journalism is presented to them, and they want something better, they want something truer, and I think that that's why what you do as artists has more resonance, I think, than what any journalist could do. And I think that there is now a reaction going on within the world of journalism that's trying to figure out how to do journalism that's about getting to the truth of the matter, not just presenting it some kind of phony balance that allows people to say, oh, well, I wasn't too offended by that, so it must be okay. I think it's a good idea to be offended. I think it's a good idea for journalists if they have the facts, not if they just have opinions, but if they have the facts that they can go out and say, therefore I make this conclusion about events. We saw in Iraq, and I think Canadians have seen in of sanitized version of reality, and that's the biggest obscenity of all.
I mean, how sanitized is it? I don't know if you saw today, I forgot if it's in the Golden Star, there's a long piece about the soldiers coming back, and it fits very much in with your Black Watch. I mean, how do they get over with the experience that they've been through? And interestingly enough, I think the Canadian Army has actually been very, having had the disaster of Delaire, they've sort of come to terms with the fact that they have to deal with these kids and the state they're going to be in. They can't turn their backs on them. I have a feeling that the states haven't gone that far yet.
No,
and I don't know about England, but they've gone that far.
I mean, it brings quite interesting. I mean, just 2 weeks ago, there was a big contrast. I mean, Scotland and Britain are losing soldiers at a ridiculous rate in Iraq and Afghanistan. Actually, Afghanistan is the real one now. That's where it's moved. And it's interesting that when Blackwood was created, one of the last lines is, off to Afghanistan next, and that was kind of almost as, it was like an afterthought, and of course that's the reality, is that's where they've gone now, and that's where they're losing people. But there was one of the tabloid newspapers in Britain did an interesting juxtaposition of Canadian soldiers coming home dead, and flags over bridges, traffic being stopped, whereas in Britain, it's completely unremarked upon. They just get buried locally, there's no fanfare, so there's a whole issue about, and I think, what this war has done in Britain, and you touched on it in your introduction, slight tangent, but rather than blame the officers, which is always the case, it's all the anger is at the South government. And in Blackwatch, the commanding officer, he's kind of a father figure, and that's what he is to those boys, those and they're his boys. He looks after them. It's the government who's going to betray him now. In terms of the technology issue as well, the interesting thing about Blackwatch is that really came from a piece of leaked journalism, which was the commanding officer James Cowan's emails to his wife were leaked by the Daily Telegraph. You know, those messages that if you've seen the show the commanding officer reads.
Oh, the DVD.
I don't know, but the Daily Telegraph got, well, somebody hit
me. Sorry.
was complicit, but
was he still serving?
He still is serving.
What rank is he?
He's commanding officer, Black Watch. And his emails appeared in the Daily Telegraph. And that was kind of one of the starting points for us. God, if he's saying that, he's really in trouble. And the whole point, every journalist we've met, particularly the embeds we've met, they've all just said, you sign a contract when you're in an embed and you're not allowed to report as honestly as you want to. And the only time we've got real clarity, there's a wonderful BBC journalist, David Loyne, who's written a fantastic piece actually for the programme The Barbican, where the show goes next. And David was a brilliant consultant to us, but it was kind of off-duty. He was telling us things that he hadn't been able to report.
And there's a combination of both censorship and self-censorship that goes on. And after 9/11, there was, and to a certain extent still is in the U.S., a very strong sense of shock and horror and anguish. And a lot of journalism that went on for a few years after 9/11 was about, well, we really can't say that word. Or there was a reporter, a British reporter for the New York Times, a woman whose name is a statement from a woman, who had the Abu Ghraib story 6 months before it came out. And she kept taking it to her editor and saying, look, I've got this and I've got evidence. And her editor at the time said, Americans couldn't do that. And that's why it was never published. And I think that one of the things that changed that was Hurricane Katrina, where all of a sudden the incompetence and cronyism and corruption of how we in America responded to, the government of America responded to Hurricane Katrina, people turned around and said, well, if it's this screwed up here, what else is screwed up? And I think that was the change that started things.
I mean, in almost listening to this, it's almost as if the traditional idea of journalism is moved closer to fiction, and the traditional idea of fiction takes its place.
Yes. Yeah, I was thinking along those lines. It's not just the sector elisions between journalism and artists, but also the media. So the different mediums that are being used. When does a documentary become fictional or have fictional elements? When does a fictional piece incorporate elements of truth? And the picture, I too was thinking about the immediate aftermath of the First World War, that incredible outpouring of literary and artistic commentary. That logic of the sort of the avant-garde doesn't hold anymore. It's much more complicated because the spectacular elements of the, even the official versions of how war is presented have an element